Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. My name is Mac McFarland, and I'm the Director of Exhibitions here at PNCA. Welcome to, which I think is our final lecture of the semester, which is very exciting, actually, and for many, many reasons. I'm going to just start by mentioning our co-sponsors and people who help make these things possible. I would just start by actually recognizing some folks in the exhibitions department. Ashley Gibson, who's the assistant curator and exhibitions coordinator here at PNCA, as well as Nicole Nathan, who's the deputy director and curator of collections over at the Museum of Contemporary Craft. This exhibition is in part sponsored by the exhibitions department and around the exhibition Alien She. Has everybody seen the exhibition Alien She? I hope. Awesome. Wow. Don't often get a round of applause for a show, so it's pretty sweet. And then co-sponsoring this lecture tonight is also the Media Arts Department, and I would just like to thank Emily Ginsberg, Sally Schoolmaster, and Teresa Christensen for co-sponsoring that. And then also sponsoring this event tonight is the Master of Fine Arts Visual Studies Program, and I would like to thank Peter for partnering up with us, Peter Siminski, who is the chair of that program, for partnering up with us to bring out Tammy Rae Carland. And I really cannot think of someone better to wrap up the year than Tammy Rae, in part because of her rigor as a maker, both aesthetically and politically, and her years of being an educator. And so I'm really pleased that we can have that be our final moment here tonight with PNCA. I would just say that you have a few more days to experience the exhibition. There's a lot to experience. There's hours of audio and video, and so it's definitely a show to come back to. So it closes January 9th. This is our last event of the semester for the exhibition. On January 9th, there will be a crocheting event up at the Museum of Contemporary Craft around Stephanie Sahuko's piece. And maybe somebody in the audience could remind me.
Bonnie Meltzer.
Bonnie Meltzer will be there with another group of crocheters, and they will be crocheting their hearts out on January 9th for the final day of the exhibition. And then sometime in February, we don't have the exact date yet, but we will be having a zine launch party. The zine is called Personal Bests, and it's edited by Jessica Fornero, who's actually here this evening. Thank you, Jessica. And the zine brings together 30 artists and activists, 30 plus artists and activists, around the question of how Riot Girl is still impacting their life today. And it's going to be a pretty amazing group of activists, artists, authors, and other individuals who have contributed to that zine. So keep your eye out for that announcement. That will also be co-sponsored by the Queer Union here at PNCA. And so I think it'll be a pretty fun party with some bands and DJs and other things. I am going to digress so we can dive into the evening. And actually, Maggie Conduit, who's a second year in the Master of Fine Arts Visual Studies program, will be introducing Tammy Rae Carland. So thank you very much for coming.
Okay. Tammy Rae Carland is an interdisciplinary artist working primarily in photography, experimental video, and small press publications. Carland received a BA from Evergreen State College in Olympia, Washington, followed by an MFA from UC Irvine, and later participated in the Whitney Independent Study Program. Carland now resides in Oakland, California, and serves as Dean of Fine Arts at California College of the Arts. Carland is one of seven artists featured in the Alien She exhibition for her work's close relationship to the Riot Girl movement and the production, presentation, and dissemination of queer and feminist culture. Emergent themes in Carland's Lesbian Bed series, Funny Face I Love You, Archive of Feeling, and other projects include love, domesticity, intimacy, narratives of marginality, self-empowerment, comedy, and rebellion. In connection to Riot Girl in the 1990s, Carland produced a series of beloved fanzines, including I Heart Amy Carter. Carland's contribution to the expansion of feminist publications was recognized with the 1997 republishing of her fanzine writing in A Girl's Guide to Taking Over the World. Tammy Rae Carland is also known for her collaborations with cornerstones of the Riot Girl music scene, such as Bikini Kill and The Fakes. Carland worked to promote much-needed representation of feminist and queer musicians and bring together a feminist and queer viewership while co-running San Francisco-based independent record label and video art distributor Mr. Lady Records and Videos from 1997 to 2005. Carland's photographs can be seen in many books, including The Passionate Camera, Queer Bodies of Desire, and Lesbian Art in America. Her work has been screened and exhibited in galleries and museums internationally. She's shown in New York, Los Angeles, San Francisco, Berlin, and Sydney, and is currently represented by Silverman Gallery in San Francisco. Please join in my fangirl delight in welcoming Tammy Rae Carland.
Hi, wow, look at everybody. It's awesome. Thanks for that introduction, that was really great. And I want to thank Mac and Ashley and Peter for hosting me the last couple days. It's been a really nice experience, and students who picked me up at my hotel and walked me from studio to studio and invited me to your class, I really appreciate it. It's been a really nice experience. I do a bunch of these things, and this has been one of my favorite, so I really appreciate it. So let's see, let me just look at the time. Center myself. Okay. So I'm going to tell a couple origin stories, partly because I like to do that when I speak at colleges, and I like to sort of think about an audience of mainly students and reflect on my own education and how I got to where I am. I think that's more interesting than just your kind of going through things chronologically. This first slide, I just want to say the image, many of you probably recognize or may recognize that photograph on the left as a Felix Gonzalez-Torres photograph. It's a photograph he took at the surface of Gertrude Stein and Alice B. Tolkis's grave in France, a snapshot he took and made into a piece of art later on in his life. And the photograph on the right is a piece I made in homage to him, just kind of a one-off project. I was asked to be in this show at the Jewish Museum in San Francisco about Gertrude Stein. It was about her legacy. And I decided what I wanted to do was recreate this piece that Felix Gonzalez-Torres had made from memory. You know, I decided to do a monochromatic version of it in all white flowers, but I didn't let myself look at the composition or look at the photograph and did a planting in my own yard in a garden bed in my yard from memory. And what really struck me by it was how much I remembered compositionally from this really very simple photograph. I remembered the feather, where the feather was. If you look at it really closely, you can kind of see, like, I got pretty close having not looked at it for a couple of years before I did this. And I always like to show this as a title piece because I think it says a lot about me as an artist and a photographer. And so this is sort of the beginning of one of my origin stories, and I'm going to show you this photograph of my parents holding this child in 1967 in South Boston, one of the many places I grew up. So I have very few images of my family. We were a family that just didn't have cameras. We were a poor welfare class, working class family. We didn't have cameras because we couldn't afford them. And we also had a couple house fires and everything was destroyed, once when I was 5 and once when I was 17. So I don't have a lot of ephemera or evidence of my childhood or really anything. But I had this one photograph and I was very sure that that was me holding my parents. And at some point in my 30s, I was showing it to a friend. I don't have the negative or anything. It's just a scrappy copy of the photograph. I was showing it to a friend and talking about my parents, and I looked at it and I realized it wasn't me. That's not me. So not me. I never had blonde hair. I was 3 at this time. You know, it's just not me. But I had sort of for 20 years been convinced that this object really kind of said something about my life with my parents and their love for me, and it wasn't even me. It's my niece. I have a sister that's much older than me and 20 years older than me, and she has a daughter a year and a half younger than me. It's her. And I was really fascinated by the sudden realization that it just, that reality came undone for me in that moment. I was at my first teaching job in Indiana. I left New York and I'd taken a teaching job at a really small liberal arts college in Greencastle, Indiana, a town of 8,000 people, at a very conservative, Christian, Republican liberal arts college. I was the biggest freak. Like, nobody had more tattoos or nobody was weirder than me. It was a really bizarre experience. And I was teaching photography for the first time. I'd gone from being in grad school and being in the Whitney program to suddenly being the professor. It was just this sort of boom, switched on a dime. Well, how did that happen? Okay, hold on. Go back over here, go like that, there. I didn't even touch anything, that was magic. So I was teaching photography and kind of thinking about photography in a way that I hadn't for a long time, and going back to sort of teaching like black and white intro photo and looking at all of these kind of early day influences for myself. But I took this photograph and I decided I wanted to dissect it and I wanted to perform my parents. And I can, you know, talk about this kind of older work I used to do that was more performance-based. But so I just really sort of dissected this photograph, and I posed myself as my dad, and then I posed myself as my mom, and I did these, you know, very costumed, authentic drag performances of my parents separately. And I did a series of photographs called On Becoming Billy and Katie, based on not having any evidence of my parents and not having this kind of family snapshot archive that most people grow up with. And to me, it was this really interesting thing of kind of inventing my parents and inventing myself, and kind of having the liberty to do that because I didn't have this evidence to prove that my story or my version was the wrong one. I also was, you know, I'm not going to show you all the historical references, but I was also quite accidentally referencing things like August Sonder and you know, Dorothea Lange with this next photograph. The other thing that came up in making this work, and I always like to, this is a story that I always share when I talk at colleges because I think it's really interesting, is when I applied for art school when I was 18 and I was in high school, I was the first person in my family to go to college, and I had a really great art teacher who was like, you should go to art school, and she helped me fill out financial aid form and college applications, and I applied to what was then called Portland School of Art, and now it's Maine College of Art in Portland, Maine, where I grew up. And I sent away for the catalog to come in the mail, even though I lived like 9 blocks from the school. And I got the catalog, you know, this is like ye olden days in the early 80s, and I got this like paper catalog in the mail. And I was looking at it, and you tore out the application in the back to apply for art school. And then they had this whole section in the back of the catalog, this alumni section, where they had work by alumni. And in the back of the catalog was a photograph of me as a 14-year-old girl hanging out in the neighborhood that I grew up in, like smoking, like leaning against it, like, oh, you know, like being the halter top on, being a wise ass. And I lived in the neighborhood that the photo students came to. Like, I lived in the poor neighborhood. I came where they came looking for grit and looking for, you know, to get their documentary chomps out. That was a really intense experience, right? Like, so instantly I was the subject. I was the material. I was the object of photography. It's a really important lesson. And I think that says a lot about how I became an artist. So I went to art school and I never, ever took a street photograph. I never was a documentary photographer. I was instantly somebody who was doing staged things. In 1983, that's pretty early days for conceptual work. Those are my origin stories that I've shared with you. They'll come up again. I dropped out of art school and just joined bands and traveled a lot and decided eventually that I wanted to go back to college, and I ended up at the Evergreen State College. So this is a photograph of my very first women's studies class I ever took, the syllabus that was made on a mimeograph machine. Suddenly these things seem really antiquated so fast, like a blue line syllabus, like from the mimeograph machine. But this was my first women's studies class I ever took. It was a class on literature. It was this really amazing class where I met three of my best friends who are still my best friends. And then we proceeded to like open up this gallery. We started taking photography classes together, and we opened up a gallery in downtown Olympia called Recluse Gallery that all these bands started playing in, which was sort of how you end up with the Alien She Show eventually. And so myself, a really good friend, Heidi Arbogast, Kathleen Hanna, who's a musician, and three other women, we started this gallery just because we could, because Olympia was that kind of town where there wasn't a gallery, so you made one. There wasn't a record label, so you started one. There wasn't anything to do, so you made something happen. I mean, it's kind of that's just sort of how it worked then. And then that's one of my notebooks. I am not a hoarder, but I'm a really good archivist, come to find out. This, just because this is in relation to the Alien She Show, I probably wouldn't normally go into this stuff, but I think it's relative to being here. This is the cover of the Bikini Kill record, Pussy Whipped, their first record. And that's a photograph of me. People always think it's Kathleen. That's a photograph I took of myself. And you can see the photographs on the right. So when I was at Evergreen, I had this persona of this kind of bad behaving little girl, and I would dress up in these sailor outfits, and I did a lot of performances in this character. And so that's sort of like a little bit where that kind of aesthetic came out of, and the sort of Riot Girl thing. So I just wanted to share that with you. And those are just work prints from my very first color photo class that ended up becoming a record, very famous record cover. Imagine that. You just never know. So I Heart Amy Carter is one of the fanzines. I've done a bunch of fanzines, but this was a fanzine that I did that was particularly important to my production, I think. It was a personal diaristic kind of fanzine. I wrote a lot about class. I was working in a domestic violence shelter, so I was writing a lot, and I was doing rape relief work, and I was writing a lot about violence, and but I was also writing about going to art school and feeling really confused in grad school about what I was doing and feeling kind of isolated. Now they're like digitally exist forever and ever, and I can never get away from it. Like you make this thing and you give it to 25 people and you just think that's that, and then 20 years later, there you are. I'm just going to show a couple of these, and these are in the Alien She Show, and you can look at them. I always had and I still do. I'm always a person who has had three or four things going at once. So in college, I started a gallery, and I made fanzines, and I made work, and I worked at this place called Safe Place. When I got my first teaching job, I had a teaching job. I had an art career. I started a record label. I just have been somebody who has done several things at once that are related as far as I'm concerned, but maybe don't always look totally related to other people. The record label I started with my partner at the time, Kaya Wilson, who actually lives here in Portland, was called Mr. Lady Records and Videos, and we started it in Indiana when I lived in Indiana at that first teaching job, and then we moved it to North Carolina for my second teaching job, and then to San Francisco for my next teaching job. These are just some of the record covers that came out of the bands that we distributed. We were an independent record label. We were really insistent that we put out feminist, queer positive music. And it was a really great project. I'm just gonna show a few of these, the lesbian beds. So, and I'm gonna just get into like talking about the art now. This project came out of probably like the early 2000s, I guess it is now. I should know. seems like a long time ago all of a sudden. These have really had a long life. All of these beds are people from my community and people that were, most of them I made in North Carolina and New York along the eastern seaboard, and I was living in North Carolina and going back and forth to New York a lot. They're all friends, they're all women that I knew personally. And it's interesting because I said that I was sort of claiming that I've never done sort of documentary photographs, and these are kind of the closest I've ever gotten to not staging something, in that everything, I was a real purist and I only photographed them as I found them. And some of them weren't found very interesting, so they never ended up in the series. So people always asked me, like, oh, did you put that book there? Or did you put that hat there? Or did you take the pillowcase off? And I didn't. I don't thought people find that interesting. But I just didn't. I really did photograph them as is. And in some ways, they were surrogates for the people, and they were portraits of my community at the time. Some of them, so this was like, you know, a single butch friend who was a union organizer, and there's her Women in Cuba book. And she's just so busy saving the world, she can't put a pillowcase on her pillow. You know, she's got a Black Workers for Justice hat. No, I did not put that vaginal slit there. I found it. This is a decisive moment. This is as decisive as I've ever gotten. These are 30 by 40. It really took me a while to figure out how to do the aerial view so that they would have that absolute tipped up on its side feeling. I did not want any angle. I didn't want any perspective. I wanted this really flattened out thing. I was looking at Rothko, and I was looking at the bed paintings that Rauschenberg and Jasper Johns made while they were being secret lovers with each other. And they both were doing a lot of work with sheets and collaging and beds, and this looks a lot like a particular Rothko composition, this heavy barred orange on the bottom and the blue on the top. And I was really interested in kind of painting and abstract expressionism and kind of querying that, like, could I, via photography, could I add this kind of lesbian, domestic, queer narrative to, like, a conversation about abstract expressionism? In my head, that's what I was doing. And I think they do, you know, they've been written about in terms of sort of the sort of painting composition of them, so I think it's this is an adult's bed. Young adult. I'm just going to go through these. I showed that first slide, and I just wanted to go back to Felix Gonzalez-Torres. So when I did the Whitney program, I was really lucky. I got to work with him about a year before he died. So when you in the Whitney program, you get assigned these mentors, and you get to meet with them periodically throughout the year. And he was one of my people, and I got to have three meetings with him. And it was those three studio visits were incredibly informative to me, like really shaped me. Like, I mean, I could talk about that for an hour. But so I was very aware when I was making these that I was referencing those bed billboards of his. It wasn't like I was naive about that. I knew there was some reference. There's also this photograph that Dorothea Lange had taken of a bed with these hairpins on the pillow that I'd had in my studio, a postcard of that for 20 years that I also was unconsciously referencing. This next series is a time jump. Again, this isn't totally chronological. I put a little narrative together for you. The lesbian had a baby. So this is like 10 years after those photographs, or more, less. Less than 10 years after. My kid's only 10, what am I saying? This is like 5 years after the lesbian beds. I had a kid, and I remember when I was pregnant and people being like, oh, you're gonna make such good mom art. I can't wait to see your mom art. And I just it made me so mad. I hated it. It still makes me cringe. And then I did, I made mom art. But the thing that was interesting is, like, I felt really defensive when people would say that. And I mean, partly it was just like, what the hell is mom art? You know what I mean? Like, you're a mom and you still make art, so it's mom art. But the thing that I realized about where that was coming from is just the level of kind of isolation I experienced those first couple of years, especially doing a lot of it on my own, and how small my world got, like how insular and closed and not public. And I went from somebody who was running this record label and was like, you know, in the magazine, like the most out person of the year one time, you know, it's like, what does that mean even, you know? And then all of a sudden I just was like a cow. It was really shocking. It was just like, I didn't have family. I was really isolated. I didn't have any family. None of my friends had done it yet. They all did it 2 or 3 years later. And then they were like, oh, we had no idea. I'm like, yeah, you didn't. But it was incredibly, I was really alone in it in a lot of ways. And it was awesome too. But I all of a sudden was like, if I don't somehow photograph this or do something with it, then I'm not gonna do anything. So I started making this series that I've never really done anything with. I've never really shown this. I'm just showing it to you. Called Postpartum Portraits, and it was a kind of riff on Mary Kelly's postpartum documents work. And they were some of the most kind of conventional photographs I've ever taken, really. The sign actually said, Happy Mother's Day, we love you, but I cropped it. and I just was really interested in the kind of anxiety and pressure to do this particular job well and how hard that is. This is my daughter's papa with his Raising Hell shirt on and her little monster feet kicking out. These are staged, so they're really, not all of them, like this happened, I saw it, but then I had to like go get the 4x5 camera and get the Polaroid back and load some film, and then, you know, so then I recreated something that had happened. I'm just gonna go through these. Oh, sorry, I just wanna go back. I'm really into these kind of, the residues of the kid, the things she kind of leaves behind, they're coming up in work now that I'm working on. This is Ace again. And this one is Rusty Love. And simultaneous to that, I started the Archive of Feelings project, which is also in the Alien She. I'm not going to show a lot of this, but the other thing that came from that kind of closed time of like hunkering down and being at home was just this, during my pregnancy, my mom passed away. And so there was a pretty, you know, yin-yang thing happened there emotionally. I had a lot of time to think. So I had a lot of time just to sort of contemplate and think about things being home alone with this child. And I really decided I wanted to make photographs that were based on sort of the disappearing nature of objects culturally, like what was happening digitally. Like I had just ended the record label and I was just sort of realizing that a lot of the things that I had been a part of, this analog culture, were changing rapidly. And I wanted to, I was really curious about how that was gonna change relationships and how people relate to each other. So this one right here, My Inheritance, it's literally just the things I took home from my mom's apartment when she passed away, which was like a half a paper bag full of things. I mean, I look at it now and I'm like, why did I take that bingo card? I mean, just, I have no idea some of these things. Like, it's her mother's ring, which I wear every day. Totally makes sense. This map of San Francisco. She'd never been past Boston, but she clearly had found this map of San Francisco in some thrift store and bought it, because I live there, you know? So the crossword puzzle that I was doing with her during chemo. But then certain things like that doily, I don't know what I, you know, just, it's so random. I'm gonna say a couple more things about this particular project. I'm gonna move on, but I left my glasses at a restaurant last night, but can you guys see that? Vaguely Dedicated, where I ripped the dedication page out of really specific books. I'm a big bookophile person. I have thousands of books. And I ripped dedication pages out of really specific books that had a referent for me. And I chose only dedication pages that I could have written. So one says, to my sisters. I have sisters. But like one says, for L. I have a very special person whose name begins with L in my life. So I really curated it to my own narrative, my own life. This is One Love Leads to Another. So these tapes, so these are all the cassette tapes, not all of my cassette tapes, but this is the most of the box that I have never thrown away. Like slowly over the years, I just throw them away. And these are the ones that I never could let go of. And I thought, well, if I photograph them, will I be able to let go of them? And some of them I can't even play. They're like, you know, that Minutemen one is like so stretched. I've had it for 30 years or something crazy like that. They're all ones that were given to me by somebody in courtship, you know, so it was the flirtation thing or the beginning of a relationship or the end of a relationship or becoming best friends or what have you. So they all had this really personal resonance, but they also really were this specific time period in terms of both the Riot Girl scene and the queer core scene that I was involved in and the people that made them, you know, there's tape that Kurt Cobain made me. They're really significant objects. And I loved making this mosaic, like this idea of like a mosaic or a tiled wall of this narrative. And it's interesting because people, as personal as it is, I was talking to a couple different students about this today, as personal and specific to my life that these objects are, so many people look at these and are like, I had almost that same tape, you know, with those same songs or... and then how important it was culturally, like I wouldn't date somebody if they made me an ugly tape. Do you know what I mean? Like the cover was so important and the pace of it. And when you flipped it over, like what was the narrative between that last song and then the next song, you know? So such important stuff. But anyways, this body of work, and there's a whole bunch more stuff. Again, all of these things are things that kind of cease to exist now because of digital technology. And I'm not like nostalgic. It's not. I don't have a nostalgia for that. I find it really interesting that the objectness of life is changing. And there are ones, you know, there are photographs of like entire relationships, like love letters from an entire relationship. That'll never happen. Like no one will ever write me a love letter every day for 6 years ever again, right? No one's ever going to do that. People don't even do that on email anymore. So I'm going to make a jump here and talk about the kind of last 4 or 5 years of my production, which may or may not seem like a jump to you. There's some things in between, but they're not. I don't care about them, so I'm not going to show them to you. But at a certain point, like around 2008, 2009, I started doing a little bit of performance stuff again. Nothing very serious, but being in videos that friends of mine were making, and I had a couple friends who were in the comedy scene, and I was kind of contributing to sketch comedy routines and whatnot. When I was in college, actually, at Evergreen, I had done this TV show, this public access TV show for the college television station. We had a television station called the Hey Lady Show. And I walked around Olympia interviewing people, and it was a comedy show. It was a sketch comedy show. And so I had this kind of history of this stuff. And I had this huge, I have a huge collection of comedy records that I started collecting when I was in high school. And I actually listened to them. Like I was a geeky person who would like put a comedy record on, you know, other people would put music on. I'd put on Mom's Mabley. So it's material that I've had in my life for a long time, and I'd never really made work about it. I think I've made work where I used humor, but I never really made work about comedy. And I got really interested, particularly in the concept of stand-up. So the act of stand-up comedy, but the concept of it, the idea of, there was something about teaching or like what I'm doing right now where you get up in front of a group of people with a microphone and you could fail. Like you know, it's all on you, you know, you're just kind of running the show. And teaching was sort of like that, and I started sort of seeing this kind of, this parallel about the one person act, and I got really interested in it. I'm going to show you this clip right now. I'll try to show you this clip. If I can remember my, go to the right, there. Then I have to look over here, and then I have to click on Gilda, which everybody should do. And then I didn't bring my DVD with me, so I have to show you. Let's mute that. Unfortunately, I have to show you via YouTube. So as soon as the ad's over, I'll. This Gilda Radner Live from New York one woman show from the late 70s. Very important to me. I'm gonna just, it's 3 minutes. And it's really poor quality, and I apologize, but I forgot the DVD. Oh. It might not work. I'm gonna just give it a second. So has anybody seen this? It's hard to find. Like, I own the DVD, but like in the hotel today, I was like, I can't believe I forgot the DVD. And I went online. I couldn't rent it. I couldn't download it. All I could find is like this person, bless his heart, like videotaped it off his TV screen or something. You know, it was playing on Comedy Central. So I'm going to show you a little bit. I might not show you the whole 3 minutes because it looks like it's lagging a little bit. But it's this one-person show that she did in the late 70s, various skits. And this one is called The Audition. And it was a real springboard for the last 5 years of my work, is this idea of the audition and sort of the tragedy of comedy, that most comedy actually is rooted in passive-aggressive critique, really. Okay, let's just look a little bit at this.
Radner, I've had extensive experience in children's theater, worked for the Board of Education. I was a theater major at University of Michigan, and I've had a year of tap and ballet when I was 8. And for my audition today, I'm going to do a number which I choreographed myself, and I wrote the song myself. Can you help me? Start there.
It worked when we rehearsed. I'll do this and I'll say a few things and I'll show a minute and then you're just going to have to go home and Google it. Okay. All of you. I was really into the aesthetic of the community theater and this idea of kind of DIY performance and the high school play or the elementary school play or what have you. It's just something that has... like it's an aesthetic that's come up, and there's a lot of work I made in undergraduate school that was on these kind of stages and using these kind of props. My work in graduate school came back to this kind of site too. So it was really interesting a few years ago to start making this work about comedy and going to these kind of community theaters and being like, where did this come from? And remembering that I had actually made all this other work that wasn't very good, but that really had used these kind of sites and these locations. When I was younger. So let me just a couple minutes of this because I want to say something about it. I'm going to stop it just for time, but I highly recommend it. Oh, I go this way. No, I go. Oh, no. Oh, no, I go this way. It's not coming back over. Oh, I go this way.
Well, all right. If you don't care what I think, then you should at least have...
Sorry. I'm looking for my cursor in my... It's going to happen. I go this way. No. Yeah, there it is. Okay.
For your
Hold
father.
On.
Now he has this...
Okay.
And it...
So then I started making work for the last 4 or 5 years, sort of using stand-up comedy as the base, but not necessarily the subject all the time. So I'll talk about that in a minute. So this piece right here in the gallery window is called Funny Face, I Love You, and it's a porcelain, life-size porcelain cast mic stand. Mic stand, stool, and water bottle. Basically the classic props of a stand-up comedian. There it is in the studio, just as a shot to show you the detail of it. All porcelain cast. I'm not a ceramicist, but I worked closely with somebody who helped me produce this piece. Originally I wanted to make it in glass. It's really hard to find people who work in glass who are friendly to work with. If you know anybody, and I teach someplace where we have a great glass facility, they just think everything's impossible. And I just don't think that's true. So I still want to do it in glass, so if you know somebody. But I was really into the idea of the ghost or the props or the trace, like the, when the person's not there, the sort of the after affect of the person. And I started with that sculpt, I started with that piece, and I was trying to sort of figure out what I wanted to do photographically. And I started photographing all these women and this really cool, really subversive, really smart underground comedy scene in San Francisco. But most of them, it was interesting. Like there are these people that I really admired their work, but they were really difficult to work with. They just didn't really understand what I was trying to do. And it ended up looking really cheesy and campy. And so I just, at one point, so this is a photograph actually of me. Like I couldn't get what I wanted from the person I was photographing that day. And so she left and I was like, friggin', I'll just do it myself. And so that's me with my daughter's blanket over, her strawberry shortcake blanket over my head. But so I got really interested in this idea of the solo performer or the abject woman, like the woman who gets up on stage and basically this idea of self-deprecation or kind of turning the joke on yourself or becoming the joke and what that could do and say. And I also was, you know, like everything is really like the lighting so that you see the water bottle and then the microphone going limp. You know, I mean, everything is really entirely staged. Maybe when you might recognize this stance from those records I just showed you, which was Bette Midler kind of turned over a stool with her legs up in the air and this kind of fluffy thing on. So in this case, again, when I was really trying to get the gears going about this work, I was like, well, I'm just going to recreate like some images that I love. And so I took that Bette Midler photograph and I recreated it with Tara Jepsen, who's a comedian. It's different but similar. And that exercise and then this next one of the unknown comic, whoops, which is from The Gong Show, which was a really bizarre TV show when I was a kid. Anybody grew up with The Gong Show? Mac. I was a member of The Gong Show fan club and I had a really big button like that big of this guy Chuck Woolery who was a total drunk, like a total drunk MC, like oh, whoa. And it was sort of like a community like talent show. People would come on and do their talents and there was a celebrity jury and they would gong you and then you'd have to leave if you got gonged. And I loved it. I would rush home, get off the school bus, run inside 4 o'clock to watch The Gong Show. I loved it. And there was this guy called the Unknown Comic who appeared with a paper bag and was terrible. It was a terrible stand-up. Did terrible. He sucked. So this is Tina Takamoto, who's a performance artist that I teach with at CCA. as the unknown comic. And then other things, again, were just like from my, there was no kind of bent banana phallic person in San Francisco. I made this one up. But my friend, Beth Lissick, who's a writer, she did work for the Fruit Guys in San Francisco, where you stand in downtown SF and you hand out fruit to people, to the office workers. It's a job. So she had access to this banana outfit. And I just really wanted a really sad, pathetic, placid lady banana crawling off the stage. So all of these are like kind of performances in my head that never really happened and never got manifested into like a full-fledged act. I just tried to find the thing, you know, the punctum. That's what a photo teacher would say, the punctum. The thing, the like prick, like what's the hit? And then I made images that were the moment. The either the punchline or the after effect of the punchline. Okay, so this piece has a sound element. So I started working, you know, I'd worked in sculpture before, but it'd been a long time. So when I made those porcelain casts, I was really excited by them. And then I made these bronze bananas called Make 'em Laugh. I made 13 of them. And it's interesting, the two places I've showed these, they refused to let me put them on the floor. They're made for, this is like, let's talk about showing art. So both institutions that I've showed these bronze banana peels at, they won't let me put them on the floor because they're an insurance hazard. Someone could trip on them. It's like, that's, do you know what I mean? It's just like, that's the point. And so, what do I have to say about that? Oh, let me just go back. Oh, so I was in the Bay Area Now show at YBCA in San Francisco, and these big, huge helium balloons in the back, which are these enormous 5-foot balloons. I did a lot of work with balloons too. There's a 2-story atrium there, and so I had to put the banana peels on pedestals, which is so stupid. I don't even like looking at that. I think it's so dumb. There's Gilda. And then the balloons, let me go. I'll go to it in a second. But there are 13 of these bronze, and they're literally bronze, so I did wax cast real banana peels. Anybody do wax casting? It's super fun. And then I worked with the bronze artist to bronze them. And this piece right here, so those are the balloons that were on the second floor atrium, and they had filament wire. It had this porcelain microphone attached to it. And as they lost air, this piece is called Airhead, as it lost air, the microphone, it would eventually come down and it would hit this little gray stage that had a sensor in it. And when it hit the gray stage, it's not gonna work now. I don't know why. It would go ba-dum bump. Sound guy heard it earlier, it worked, it's not working now. And then the whole thing about it was, with the curators, it was like, well, what happens if nobody's here? And that's what happened. It happened like on a Sunday night and nobody was there in the middle of the night. Ba-dum-bum. It's kind of like that Yoko Ono piece with the phone, you know, the white phone. I remember standing in a museum for 3 hours being like, it's going to be me. She's going to call and I'm going to answer and I'm going to talk to her. It's going to be so cool. So it was this interesting thing of like it took like 9 days for the balloons to totally lose air because they're huge. And when a microphone finally touched down at the stage and it made the rim shot, the ba-dum bump, nobody was there. It's the tree in the forest. Okay. So here's more of these. This is Carolyn Mitzi, who are a great performance art, amazing, work with a lot. And again, I'm making up all these performances. These aren't really their performances. I'm gonna go so I can show you the last body of work and we can have time to talk. This was really dangerous. This was a hard one. Like, she almost got really hurt. But I was really into these like precarious, dangerous, sort of abject, kind of messed up. You know, people have said like, well, aren't you humiliating these women? I mean, you're putting a dog cone on her and making her climb. And And it's they're totally collaborative. You know, people are doing this willingly with me, and they know the idea before we do the shoot. And I am talking about humiliation, and I'm talking about self-humiliation, and that line between kind of what is abject and kind of the lengths that some people have to go, or that women have to go specifically. This is my last solo show that I had at Jessica Silverman Gallery in San Francisco, which is the gallery I work with. And so I filled that whole front kind of alcove of the gallery, this sort of glass part that you can't see into the gallery through, with these big helium balloons, HA. So it's like, ha, 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 ha. But it also was, ah, 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 or aha, you know, depending. And they lasted a really long time, but eventually they started to get all crinkly and ugly and just kind of fall and became their own thing. Also in the show were these, again, trying to find a good glass person to work with, hook me up. I really wanted these ladders to be made of glass, and it proved to be, like, I couldn't just find the right person to work with. I did make one that was pretty nice, but I made these ones out of just really highly polished plexiglass. I was really interested in those ladders from, like, Laurel and Hardy movies or Charlie Chaplin movies, those really long ladders, and the person walks with the ladder and they move and it hits somebody in the ass, and then they go into the bucket and then the bucket goes. I was really into that kind of pratfall effect and the idea. And then there's this thing called the pratfall effect, which is a political term, which is if a politician or somebody, you know, somebody of notoriety makes a screw up, their capacity to bounce back and maintain their stance as like a believable person is called the pratfall effect. So if they fail, it is a pratfall effect. Like, whew. Or I'm sorry, if they don't fail, then they succeeded to make like humor out of their mistake or what have you. So this show had like basically two different bodies of works in it. One of them, and I'll come back to it, on the left-hand side, are these kind of recent things I've been working on. I've been doing more of these kind of differently lately, called discograms, where I'll actually come back to that when I show them close up. It was my gallery had moved into this really big space, like 3,000 square feet. It was pretty intense, and she did it within 2 months, like 2 months before my show. So I all of a sudden had to like go from the 800 square foot gallery that I was making work for to the 3,000 square foot gallery. So I'm just going to show you some installation shots, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about this work. So there are four different elements. There's a video piece. There are these megaphones. I also was really, really looking at kind of the history of vaudeville. So I stopped photographing. I made a lot more of those photographs with the comedian women, like the women in these kind of stand-up routines. And I had started making things of just the spaces and just the stages and then the empty places. And I was doing a lot of research in San Francisco of all these movie theaters that were once vaudeville theaters. So they were vaudeville theaters, and then they were movie theaters, and then they were porn theaters, and then they were art house movie theaters and or cabaret drag sites. Like, that's been the trajectory of all of them. And since I made this work, started photographing them 3 years ago, half the ones I photographed are nothing. They just are closed now and going to be condos or something. So I'm just giving you the long shots. And then the megaphones are coming from both the vaudeville MC, the idea of the MC, the master of ceremonies, too. But the photographs, so they got kind of bigger. So these ones were much bigger. They were like 50 by 60. The other photographs I was doing was smaller. A couple of these are in the Alien She Show. And I exclusively photographed at these sites that were once vaudeville. And I was really interested in taking the talent completely out of the image and what happened when, they remind me a lot of the lesbian beds. So like the beds are kind of stages for a particular identity, and then these are the to this one, like the duet one without the duet. I'm just going to go through these so we have time to chat. Yeah, so I could say more about these, but I'm going to just keep going. I made the I made these brick walls. I made them out of brick wallpaper, and I made these props, and I went to all these different sites, and I just made really specific kind of decisions about the kind of photograph I wanted to take at any given site. This one sort of reflects back to the album covers that I showed you too, the picture of Carol Burnett as the house cleaner lady with the mop. That was a really formative thing for me. This one's called Ghost Light. So a ghost light in a theater, if you've ever worked in theater, a ghost light is a light that is kept on a stage at night in case there's a fire. So that if any kind of emergency people, fire people have to come, they won't fall off the stage. It also comes from like keeping the ghosts away or something, but it's actually really a real thing. And then the discograms, I'll just say what these are really quickly. So these are really big. They're probably like 50 by 60 or 70 or 80. They're different sizes. They're actual photograms. So I installed a disco ball in the mural darkroom, and then I put mural photographic paper on the wall, and then I used the enlarger, the analog enlarger to hit the disco ball, and then the reflection from the mirror disco ball onto the photographic paper, and then Troth printed these. So they're really these big things. And so it's again looking at that idea of the solo performance or the empty stage, and I started thinking about, this has been a segue into a book I just finished called Some of Us Did Not Die, where I just am looking at reflecting back to my 20s and 30s and the AIDS epidemic. And so I made these as portraits for friends who died of AIDS. So they're all these kind of individual. And then there was also this video that's going to play right now. It's an endless loop of a spotlight that's looking for the talent that never appears. And so it just goes on and on and on and on. And the talent never shows up. And it's inspired by the very beginning of Gilda Radner's Life from New York, if you go home and watch it, which I know you're all going to go do. The very, very beginning of it, before she comes out, it takes place at Winter Garden in New York, and before she comes out on stage, there's about 7 seconds of this handheld spotlight, like not a digital, like an analog, like human-controlled spotlight, kind of looking for her before she comes through the curtain. And I just was always really found that to be really beautiful. And so I just took that gesture and I extended it. I think the loop is like 17 minutes, but it plays for an infinite amount of time and nobody ever comes. I guess what I would say to wrap up those, that whole last body of work, I was really interested in this idea of performance anxiety in terms of although I don't really have that, just so you know. It's like I actually have no performance anxiety, which is funny that I wanted to make work about it. But I got really interested in that idea of space being anxious, or could you make an audience, particularly an audience who are looking at art, which is not something that you usually totally try to manipulate, like could you create some sort of sense or feeling or the affect of anticipation or anxiety or kind of loneliness? From the omission of the talent, basically. And that's sort of where this body of work has stopped. I started doing some video with the pratfalls recently, but that was the last body of work. And I'm going to stop there just because it is 7:30, exactly. And then you guys could ask me some questions if you want to. Does that sound good? Yeah? Okay. So we can take a few minutes if everybody's not too restless, and I can. If anybody has any questions. Yeah. taken over by what?
Like, I don't know, blog sites, things like that.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I know the curatorial practice program at CCA. There's a two-year MA program in curatorial studies there, and they're the second year's their show is actually about artist scenes. So there does seem to be something really current, I think, in the art world. I mean, the Alien She show, it's specifically about a certain genre. Their focus is really on, like, Destroy All Monsters from Detroit, like that whole, like, the punk artist scene, the curt people that are doing their show. So I think there is a kind of currency now. I can't really speak to it in terms of, like, youth culture and how are people doing it? I don't know. They are, right? Okay. I don't know. I'm 50. Nobody sends them to me. I don't know. What do you think? Yeah. Well, I think we have, like, blogs and Tumblr and Instagram and Facebook. I mean, I don't know. Would I have, like, I don't know. It probably wouldn't have been my form if I was 20 now. You know, I don't know. And there are all these other ways to do the kind of same thing. I mean, I grew up in such a time of pen pal culture. It's like, that's how you communicate. It was too expensive to use the phone. Like, we didn't have phones in college. Like, you went and used the payphone. It was too expensive. Can you imagine, you guys? Wow. It's true. And so you wrote. Like, you wrote letters. So, I don't know. I mean, I think anything can be relevant. And I certainly don't want to be the person that says something is or isn't relevant. Because I think it might not seem relevant to a bunch of us in this room. And then some wacko group of kids in Oklahoma all of a sudden start something and it's totally awesome.
Is music still something that informs your work?
Not really. That's the honest answer. I mean, I think it does just because it's part of me. It was such a part of my formative time. But I don't think so. I mean, I think the comedy is much like that in some ways. Like, that was always a parallel interest for me. Like, I always was hanging around with the performance people and the sketch comedy people. So it kind of flipped a little bit in that direction. Not so much. Yeah. I mean, that changed too. Like, I think when I ran a record label was a really specific time culturally in terms of running record labels, and they're just different now. Like, things are disseminated so differently. So, did somebody have a question?
Do you see yourself doing like a stand-up routine in the future, or like an hour-long routine, and maybe like taking it out on the road?
You see me doing it. I'm my new manager, Jason. No, it's so funny. Like, at Caddist, this art institute, this art space in SF, like, I did a presentation there, and it was like, Tammy Rae Carland, stand up. And all these people came to see me do stand up. And I was just talking about stand up. But I was playing records. I actually was DJing stand up comedy, so they got something out of it. But I don't really see myself doing that. There, I don't. You know, it's interesting. Like, you know, well, how can I be so interested in it and not do it? It's very metaphorical for me. You know, it's very much the sort of metaphor, the subject of it, and not the activity of it. Although I like to go and watch it. Mm-hmm. Her new band? No.
Or just like how she's been going around and doing sort of these engaging, well, yeah, with her band, and they're like kind of these engaging talks.
Do I think of that as like stand up?
Yeah, would you do something similar like that? Sort of like going back to what you've gone through, like, and then like,
I mean, I definitely have given talks that are like more like the history of Riot Girl or the history of this time. You know, I've done those kind of things for sure. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, or like incorporating like...
I can't hear the last part.
Like incorporating music and...
Oh, no. I quit being in bands on purpose. Yeah, no, I mean, that's not... You know, I was in bands for many years, for a big chunk, and then I purposely just stopped and was like, yeah, I'm an artist. I didn't like the band culture.
I was just curious if you could talk a little bit more about your interest in sort of the abject woman,
mm-hmm.
like performance as humiliation, mm-hmm. and kind of your attraction to comedy.
Yeah, so it's interesting. I was thinking about this just the other day. Like, I read this book when I was in grad school called Men, Women, and Chainsaws or something like that. You know that book? Yes. What's her name that wrote that? I would talk about that a lot in my life, and then I haven't for the last 10 years. But it was just real, because I had made these photographs of horror girls, of girls from horror movies who... So myself as Carrie, myself as Reagan from The Exorcist, myself as the Drew Barrymore, the Firestarter, and myself as the Shining twins. You know, I made those that work in grad school. And that book was really formative because it talked about horror and pornography as sites of resistance, that they are such, you know, they are such popular culture narratives that don't try to cinch everything up and close in a proper way or follow the line of Hollywood. They can just, you know, the plumber shows up and is like, hey, you know, in porn, like, when does that ever happen, right? They just go off script, and you have to suspend so much disbelief to engage with them. So that's something I really got from that book. And then I got the idea, then I was really influenced by her notion that, so if you look at Carrie, the movie Carrie, right, and you think, like, this girl is sort of the victim of these other students, and she's being bullied, and she's her mother, but she also has all this agency in her victimhood, you know, that, and it's that bell hooks thing that marginality is a site of resistance, that sometimes living in the margins and not being a part of mainstream culture or not having full access allows you the liberty and privilege to invent yourself off script. You're not held to the same manners or notions. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's so interesting you bring that book up because I really do see a correlation between comedy and horror in that way.
I do too. Yep.
To face things that we really don't want to see and we deliberately engage.
Absolutely.
In order to see what we don't want to see.
Yeah. When I do a talk and I just talk about that new work, I go way into more depth around that idea of comedy as a sort of site of political. I mean, it really is historically a site where sort of politics get acted out, where it doesn't really happen anywhere else, you know.
I really like hearing about like your origin and when you connected to your work. I guess my question is, as you move forward in your life and work, how often do you find yourself reaching
I mean, I think I know what you're asking me. Well, it's interesting because I just did this book and I didn't really talk about it, but I donated my zine collection to the Fales Library, to the Riot Girl collection at the Fales Library, which is part of NYU in New York, and it was 350 fanzines I had that were Riot Girl and queer core fanzines that I had collected that people had given me and I bought over like a 10-year period. And then the archive for my record label. So those things, and so I had to unearth all of this stuff, and it led to that book, this book I made, which was looking at my life from 1986 to 1989, so the time I was 21 till I was 24, something like that. So I really just did that exactly kind of what you were asking. Like, I just did this whole unearthing and kind of really meditative project about that. But I don't, not really. Yeah, I mean, I don't, I'm a little bit of a object person, and I collect things, and I have a lot of stuff, but I don't necessarily think it's always going to be, like, material or reference, you know? Like, the work I made after having the baby, it's not work I've shown or really done anything with, like, it's something that was completely immediate in the moment, and I felt like I needed to do something that was really about the now. I'm going to think about that one a little bit, because I actually think I do a little of both all the time. Should I let you guys go? Oh, yeah.
So you had mentioned kind of starting a gallery,
mm-hmm.
Working collaboratively with the record label with a lot of people. Would you have any advice for like a group that was trying to go forward?
Oh, yeah.
Like a gallery that
yeah. Gosh, I learned so much in doing those projects. What would my advice be? I mean, it's totally corny, but just do it. Like, just do it. Like, I think if you overthink it and over, you're going to talk yourself out of it. I think part of the reason I did most of the things I did is because nobody told me not to, or I didn't have any adults in my life. I didn't have parents. You know what I mean? I didn't have people being like, oh, you can't do that. Oh, you're using your financial aid money for rent on a gallery. You can't do that, you know? But I did. You know what I mean? Like, part of the reason I did anything, even with the record label, we were like, we're a record label. And then we said it in a magazine article, and then somebody wrote us a check out to Mr. Lady, and we're like, shit, now we have to go to the bank and get a bank account and be a real record label because somebody sent us a check. And same thing with Riot Girl. It's like people all over the country was like, yeah, Riot Girl, we have a Riot Girl chapter, so do we. If people didn't, they just did because they said they did, right? Because no one told them not to, so I'm not going to tell you not to. And just have a shared mission, like write a shared mission. I know when we started this gallery, we wrote a mission, and there were a couple times when we had to like kind of live up to it, that somebody disagreed with something that we wanted to show. And we had to have like 6 hours of feminist processing conversation about why it was against the mission, you know? And I was the person that's being like, no, we should show this work. And then my best friend was like, absolutely not, I'll quit, you know? But we had that text and I had to be like, you're right. We wrote the shared mission and this is not within our mission, and I just have to kind of follow that. So that's like one thing I learned, you know? I don't know if that's helpful. Huh. I mean, I think for me, family is community. Like, as a queer person, it's not nuclear or normative. You know, like I co-parent with my ex who's trans, and you know, my daughter calls my friend's kids her chosen family siblings. You know, it's like my version of family is so not traditional, and I think. Like both in the punk scene that I came out of, the gallery scene with this group of really strong, amazing women in Olympia, and then Riot Girl, and then my record label. Those were all kind of families to me that I invented myself. So I think it's related in that way, you know. And then I think the work about family, and there's other work I did about family, like I think it's a little sarcastic too. Like I'm not so sure that I'm being really, you know, like if that me, my daughter wearing that shirt that says me, is like not like, oh, she's so cute. It's like, oh my God, she's a selfish little blob taking up everything. You know what I mean? There's some irony and some angst in that work, you know, that's not fluffy. Does that answer your question? Okay. Okay. Oh, someone raised her hand. Oh. Peter's wanting me. Okay, go ahead.
I was just curious about your creative process. Like, if you had anything to share, like, how much, you know, do you walk and talk to yourself? Do you write things through sketch? Like, you know, how much of it is, like, really choreographed? How much of it is impulsive? Like,
I'm a pretty choreographed person. You know, like I was saying that to one of the grad students today. Like, I have to tell myself to not follow the list. You know, like, don't follow the list. Don't follow the list. You know, I have to do that. But I also am really impulsive. Like, the strawberry shortcake photograph, which I love that piece. You know, it's one of my favorites. That was in a dream. I had a dream that I was doing stand-up comedy, and I was too scared, so I put on my daughter's blanket. It's like, oh, that's a beautiful photograph, you know? So that's kind of intuitive and impulsive. Like, I think I go both ways, but I'm a pretty strategic person. I have I'm a dean now. Like, I have a really hard-ass job, you guys. And I have to be really strategic with my time. Like, I have really specific studio days, and I go and I do that, and there's other things I need to do, but I don't, and I go into the studio, and I don't always get anything done. Like, sometimes I'm literally like, I guess I'll clean up my bookmarks on my computer. But I'm in that room, you know? Like, that's the one piece of advice I'd give you is, like, so, but yeah. I'm actually trying to figure out how to be more playful, like, and remember that part of myself, because things are so structured in my life right now that it's getting a little stiff. So I have to figure that out. I used to write a lot, though. Writing used to be a big part of it, but not so much anymore. Thanks, you guys. I'm gonna let everybody go. Bye.